What's up, everybody? Welcome back to another highly combustible reaction. We're going to be jumping into the next one on our Dutch Golden Age journey. Now that we've got some of the slower episodes being translated, thanks to Paul H. Seriously, Paul comes in with the save almost every single time. Let's jump into this. Let's check it out. It's coming at us from Mikael. Much love for keeping us on the history journey. Legit, it's a fun journey. We are going to cut it into two pieces so that we'll have two 20-minute long videos so that it's not too much for anybody to watch. And we'll drop part one today, part one tomorrow. Let's jump into it. Let's go.
This was a sort of Hollandse hoek.
What? CC's. I forgot about that.
Yeah.
De Gouden Eeuw werd Nederland legendarisch rijk. Maar waar kwam die rijkdom vandaan? En wie zaten erachter?
Oh, here's my kind of guy. He didn't do it for the king, he did it to make money.
Een reis naar de Oostzee. Op zoek naar een Nederlands handelsimperium. Zo opgebouwd dat het toen haast niet zichtbaar was en dat we er nu niet meer van weten.
For me, it's sort of a WikiLeaks document.
Get away. No.
Polen. De buitenwijken van Gdansk, het oude Danzig. Een stad die altijd verbonden is geweest met scheepvaart. Daar ligt de beroemde Leninwerf. Bakermat van de vakbond Solidariteit die het communisme op de knieën dwong. De recente geschiedenis wordt hier in ere gehouden. Maar ik wil verder terug in de tijd. Naar de 17e eeuw, toen Danzig een van de belangrijkste missies was van Nederlandse kooplieden op de Oostzee. Hier was handel. Hier wilden ze naartoe. Een afspraak met Justina Wups, een Nederlands stukje Polen. Woont in Leiden, maar onderzoekt in Gdansk de internationale handel van de 16e en 17e eeuw.
Bijvoorbeeld hier moet ergens een lofzang op de Nederlandse kaas in staan. Dat heb ik nog niet kunnen vinden, maar dat komt later. En dit is een bron die over Hollanders in Gdansk gaat vanaf de middeleeuwen.
Speciaal over de Hollanders?
Ja. Ja.
Was dat ook de grootste buitenlandse groep die naar Gdansk kwam?
Ja, dat was zeker de belangrijkste buitenlandse groep, die vrij snel ook integreerde.
Hm. Okay. Gulf of Danzig?
Ja, dit is de Oostzee. Hier is de Sond. Ja,
dus dit is Denemarken, zeg maar? Ja. Dus dan is Nederland ergens hier?
Ja. Oké. Okay.
En schepen kwamen via de Sond naar Danzig toe.
Wacht even, hier is Danzig.
Ja, Danzig was de graanhoofdstad van Europa. Er werden honderdduizenden tonnen graan vervoerd naar de Nederlanden.
En de Nederlanders vervoerden het ook verder door Europa heen?
Ja, ja.
Dus de Nederlanders...
Spanje, Italië... Je kunt zeggen
so they
dat
leapfrogged
vooral Amsterdam een soort draaischijf in de graanhandel. Maar die handel die was zo belangrijk voor de Nederlanden dat het de moedernegotie genoemd werd.
De moeder van alle handel is het. Maar je hoort altijd dat het grote geld verdiend werd met de handel op Azië, Indonesië, China, Japan, de VOC.
Ja, maar de Oostzeehandel wordt zwaar onderschat. De cash cow die zat hier. Dat was de financiële basis voor verdere uitbreiding.
Look at that giant. See? It's such a quaint little town. Then you got this massive old cathedral. And a lot of towns are like, that's what I want to see. Let's go on a cathedral journey or something. Something old. Look, even down here, there's ruins to something right here on the grounds in front of us. Like, oh, I need to go somewhere really, 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 really old.
Hart van de stad? Is dit helemaal het centrum?
Ja, dat is het centrum.
That is still a wooden boat sailing right there. That was a ship.
Maar hier konden de schepen aanmeren en weer vertrekken.
Als we hier in de 17e eeuw zouden staan, wat zou je hier zien?
Je zou wel heel veel
pakhuizen zien aan beide kanten hier. Pakhuizen vol met graan. Je zou,
Want die ruïnes daar, dat zijn ook pakhuizen.
Ja,
dat
zijn okay. That's what they are.
Je zou hier een heleboel schepen met graan en ook vreemde schepen met vreemde kooplieden zien.
De handelaren die hier naartoe kwamen, dat waren Hollanders, Engelsen en ook mensen ook uit andere landen.
Hoeveel Hollanders waren dat?
In de 17e eeuw schat men dat het om duizenden Hollanders.
Op een totale bevolking van?
Ja, 50.000 tot medio 17e eeuw 70.000.
Dus veel Nederlanders woonden hier ook?
Ja.
I love this damn show. They don't leave anything out. They just really kind of take you all the way.
Hoe een schip eruit zag in de tijd?
Ja, het is wel iets in die richting. En ik denk dat ze minder hard zouden gaan.
Dit is een beetje Pirates of the Caribbean, hè?
Ja, zeker. Wil je nog een middeleeuws toren kopen? Deze is te koop.
Deze?
Ja.
Het is een stadspoort.
Ja.
Wat zou je hier nou van kunnen maken?
They make money on having your money and protecting.
Het is ook een heel ander soort gebouw, hè?
Ja, het is een van de voorbeelden van Nederlandse invloed in de architectuur in Gdańsk. Het werd ontworpen als residentie voor de Poolse koningen. Maar er is nooit een koning hier verbleven. De enige die nu hier woont is...
When you watch this show, you're just literally going through every step of the way history. It's like I'm there. It's like we're traveling about all these. I don't know how we got so many damn historians that know so much, but thank God for them. We need to be able to learn on our own because obviously school doesn't teach us what we need them to.
Talk about what answer. Ja, dit is de apotheose van Gdańsk, dus lofzang op Gdańsk. Hier wordt de stad als een ideaal stad afgebeeld.
Look at all the paintings on the ceiling, it's miraculous. Ah! Magnificent!
Bijvoorbeeld iets in een latere periode monsters van graan hier getoond. En over onderhandeld welke wel de hoogste prijs mochten halen en welke niet. Er was bijvoorbeeld één tafel, een gedeelte waar de Hollandse broederschap bij elkaar zaten.
Dus dat was een soort Hollandse hoek?
Ja.
Er waren dus een paar duizend Nederlanders, vaak in de elite. Kregen die dan ook invloed op het straatbeeld?
Ja, dat kan je heel goed in de huizen zien. De Nederlandse architecten waren in trek. En je kon het ook gewoon zien, de mode die op straat heerste. De Nederlandse mode was hip.
De grote witte molenkragen, zwart daaronder.
Dat zie je ook op sommige façades hier afgebeeld.
Zijn het archeologen aan het werk?
Ja, het zijn opgravingen aan het doen in pakhuizen. Hier stonden meer dan 300 pakhuizen vol met graan.
That's very cool that they're actually going through and seeing what they can find.
Economisch gezien was dat het belangrijkste gedeelte van de stad. Hier werd het graan bewaard dat onder andere naar de Nederlanden verscheept werd. En, eind 16e eeuw en ook nog begin 17e eeuw zeiden de Spaanse diplomaten die hier in Danzig waren dat zonder dat graan dat hier verzameld werd en verscheept werd, zou de opstand snel ophouden.
De Nederlandse opstand tegen Spanje, want daar kwam het echte geld vandaan.
Ja, dit graan voedde de opstand.
Letterlijk.
Letterlijk.
Ja. En dus de fundamenten van deze pakhuizen zijn ook een beetje de fundamenten van de opstand in Nederland. En daarmee de fundamenten van onze Gouden Eeuw.
Ja.
Nou, dan kijk je er toch anders tegenaan.
Ja.
Most of grain is coming from Poland, of course. It's mostly coming from the neighborhood of Gdynia and Gdańsk area, from the mouth of Vistula River and also from the eastern part of Poland.
So what you're doing here, in fact, is what the Dutch were doing here in the...
How is there just a giant bin of grain outside, like, unprotected? What happens if it rains? We don't care if the grain gets... That's a lot of damn... Oh, maybe they got a roof they could pull over
part of
it.
Poland.
So what you're doing here, in fact, is what the Dutch were doing here in the area in the 17th century.
I mean, the trade, the basic of the trade are exactly the same. The cargo is exactly the same. It's the same wheat.
Where does the export go to?
I mean, the grains mostly are exported to Benelux countries, the Netherlands, Belgium, Ireland, also to...
Really? Still Benelux countries?
Yeah, because we have a surplus of grains and the Netherlands are the deficit countries, so it's a natural fit.
And are there still Dutch traders?
Yeah, because the terminal is owned 50% by Cefetra Group, the Dutch company.
You're kidding.
No, that's true.
A Dutch company? This is 50% owned?
Yeah.
By the Dutch?
Nowadays it's 50% Dutch company.
Op weg naar Denemarken. Aan de Oostzee, bij het plaatsje Helsingør, ligt kasteel Kronborg. Pal aan de Sond, de zeestraat tussen Denemarken en Zweden. Smaller dan ik dacht. In de 17e eeuw voeren de schepen vanuit de Nederlanden om het Deense schiereiland heen naar deze plek. De toegangspoort naar Polen en Rusland. Maar voor niets ging de zon op. Om bij de rijkdommen van de Oostzee te komen, moest tol worden betaald. Hoe zou het er toen hebben uitgezien, zo'n 400 jaar geleden?
So the Dutch, they were coming from, let's say, Amsterdam. They were coming from that direction. And they wanted to sail through the Sound into the Baltic Sea. For instance, to Gdansk.
Yes. Normally, they started coming in April. And in the summer, their number would be very big. You have to see a forest of masts here. They could come in convoys at 100 or 200 ships at one time.
Whoa!
And anchored up at the coast here. The castle was the guard for the Sound. It wasn't possible for a ship to pass by here without being noticed on the castle. And if they did not stop, or if they did not lower their topsail, then a gun was fired at them. And they had a revenue in the Sound toll books called shooting money. It was so that the skipper had to pay for the shooting.
So they would shoot at you and you'd have to pay for the bullet.
Wow!
And it was a big amount, $4. Really, you had to stop.
You're gonna shoot at me and then charge me a fine for the bullet.
Was extremely important for the Danes because the Sound dues paid the kings of Denmark a salary each year. Now, very first thing that he did, that he was king of Denmark, he declared war on Sweden because Sweden was our enemies. And, well, we know today also that war tends to cost a lot of money. So he said, you just have to pay 1% of your cargo. And so they would reach their destination and sell their goods and trade with other people.
France, the early Middle Ages until today.
So many records, it's amazing.
Right here we do have the famous Sound Toll registers. On these shelves, all in all, it takes up 600 boxes.
600 boxes.
Yes. So. It's a little more than 60 meters if you place them next to each other.
Okay.
Okay, so from the, the Dutch heydays.
Yeah, sure. You have the golden complete. Century of the Netherlands is richly represented here. Most of the ships in the 17th and early 18th century were Dutch.
Oh, it's so cool.
The dust of the ages is on there.
Right, yes. And the system is so that the register here starts with a special section for Dutch ships coming from the Western or Northern Sea, the North Sea.
Yeah.
If you go on to March, for example, you'll see large fleets of Dutch ships. Like here, for example, we have a handful coming. For example, Evert Donker from Terschellingen came from Danzig.
We had such better handwriting back in the day. I can't
and
write like
we
that.
We have the cargo listed here with 38 lasts of rye, 15 lasts of wheat, some linen, some wax, etc. So here you have the sum for January, which is 160.5 riksdollars and 6 shillings.
So how much money was that?
That was quite a lot of money. The total revenues from the sound tolls in Elsinore would make up maybe half, at times at least, half of the total income of the Danish state. So that
really?
Was quite a lot of money.
Now, this is the ballroom at Kronborg Castle, and when it was built, it was actually the largest one in Northern Europe. And in here, you can see some very beautiful paintings from the Dutch painter Gerrit van Honthorst. Because King Christian IV simply loved the Netherlands. He was very inspired by them. Now, it's not always been like that, because the Netherlands sometimes supported Sweden just on the other side. Because it was very important to Europe, and especially the Netherlands, who lived off trading, that the sand dew out here wasn't that expensive. If Sweden or Denmark had too much power, then the Netherlands had to support the country that had the least power in order to make sure that Denmark or Sweden wouldn't grow too strong. Because that was...
Glasharde verdeel- en heerspolitiek. En toch was de Deense koning dus dol op Nederland. Met kooplieden uit de Republiek was het goed zaken doen. Die zaken begonnen met graan en hout. Maar er bleek meer lucratieve handel te zijn. IJzer, koper, wapens. Aan de Sond hoor ik van het bestaan van een Amsterdamse koopman die met al die handel zelfs een beslissende invloed kreeg op de Deense staat. Zijn naam? Gabriel Marcelis. Hoog genoteerd op de quote 500 van de Gouden Eeuw. Ergens op het Deense platteland, ten noorden van Kopenhagen, wordt hij levend gehouden.
Thank you so much for
your
welcome.
Hello.
Hans.
Hello. Welcome.
Good to see you.
Yes, well, here you are. And all his family is all around you.
What a gorgeous place.
Yes, it is a lovely place. It's one of the oldest houses here in this area. So, yes, I've restored it completely from the ground. It was a wreck when I found it. But I had to have lots of room for my family.
That's
this
very
is
cool.
Gabriel Marcelis.
Yes.
Your great ancestor.
My great ancestor and his lovely wife, the first one. And
she's then, beautiful.
And she, you know, she died when she was, I think, 34. And then we got this one here. Then there was a second wife. But you see, the first wife, when she dies, the bow You see, the string of the bow is cut off. It's cut. That means that she is dead, and now she is alive. That's the second way.
So you are an heir of one of these two ladies.
This one, the beautiful one, of course.
Of course, of course. I should have known.
I should have known, yes.
We are in your hallway.
Yes.
So you see this man every day.
Every day,
you
yes.
You live with this guy on a daily basis.
That is so cool that his ancestors came around and took up the helm and they're showing off all this stuff and is so into their like history. I think it's a freaking badass that it's still someone who's somewhere along the line in that family.
I see them, all my guests, the first thing they see is Gabriel Marcellus. He was full of initiative. He was independent. He didn't do it for the king. He did it to make money. And I think what I'm doing is also to make money. And I was born in a family which went all the down the drain. So I started from zero. But now I'm here, and I'm quite rich.
Back to the old standards.
Back to the old standard, yes, more or less.
So he is really your kind of guy.
Oh, he is my kind of guy. Yes, yes, yes. Independent, working hard, making guns and weapons, and he also. Set up a shipyard for warships. Yes, he was a clever guy. So, here you come in the next room again. Family portraits all over the place. And here I have it put up a different books about the Marcellus family. This is a book about the Danish nobility.
So what did Marcellus do for the Danish king and the Danes that made him so important?
Well, you see, the 30-year war made Denmark so poor that they had no corn to sow, so we risked that the whole population would die. Who comes to the risk? Gabriel Marcellus, 20 years old only. He arranged
20 years old,
each with 40 tons of corn from Russia to Denmark. That saved the Danish population. And
a 20-year-old got them the food that they needed to save themselves.
Later, during the war against the Swedes, he brought 10,000 soldiers, including weapon, including provision, to the Danish king to fight the Swedes. Now, the king couldn't pay him back. And that's why, you know, he offered him all this land, whole islands here. And at the end, he was the most wealthy land over in the whole of Denmark. That was a point when he didn't have more land to give. And then he said, okay, give me the crown. And there you see the crown. Gabriel Marcellus brought it to Holland, a fantastic crown that he kept under his bed or wherever he kept it for a number of years until the next king was to be crowned. And he said, where the hell is my crown? Maybe he didn't use that expression. And so Gabriel Marcellus came back with the crown. But of course, a businessman, I want money or whatever. And he got even more land. So as I said earlier, he became the largest landowner in Denmark because of all these things.
Very, very cool. That's where we're going to cut it off for today. We will finish up part two tomorrow. Most certainly a fascinating, fascinating journey. If you guys enjoyed it, go over and show Paul H. some love on his channel. Go show Doko Doko some love as well. Hit the like button if you liked it, the dislike button if you disliked it. Check out the other video that's somewhere up on the screen. Check out one of these other reactors above me. They're part of the Creator Consortium Discord that we share together. Till the next one, I'm Holly Combustible. You guys be happy, healthy, safe. Love you to the moon and back. Peace.